All right, greetings. Shalom. I am Alonzo coming to you from Southern California. Today is June 19th. Seeking to support and assist the Lion of Judah Society. So, all willing, no contribution is too small for the kingdom of His Imperial Majesty. And so that being said, the last three Torah portion studies, or better yet, the Rastafari sabbatical studies of the past three Shabbats have been RSS number 34, 35, and 36, which are in the book of Numbers. And so, let's get into the numbers and let's get the ball rolling. And so there's a lot more to the ball rolling, but we'll get to that soon enough. So I guess let's get started by establishing that the Levites, which were appointed to carry out the service of the tabernacle, were in fact not so much of a tribe, but rather a family. So that being said, all within the Rastafari family, Shema, listen, because there's a lot of important and interesting information that'll link I and I to somehow resemble the tribe, well, the Levites, the tribe of Levites. Okay, so those that were, appointed to carry on the services of the tabernacle were the Merarites, the Kohathites, and the Gershonites. And so, okay, let's see if we can get that. Well, okay. I guess I'll write that down on the next vid. So let's establish how the Levites began and what they are exactly. So in order to do that, let's go to Genesis, first open up your scripture and let's go to Genesis chapter 29. And we're going to go to verse 34. Okay, and this is speaking about Leah. Okay, and verse 34, chapter 29 of the book of Genesis, it reads, "And she conceived again and bare a son and said, Now this time will my husband be joined to me, because I have borne him three sons. Therefore was his name called Levi." Okay, so let's see, Levi. It represents coming together and joining. In this case, Leah is saying that now for sure, like, my husband's gonna join that because I've given him three sons, and for this reason, I will call him Levi. And so let us go on to. Okay, let's go to. Okay, let's just go to the book of Exodus, chapter 2. Bear with I that I promise there's great information, but since it's been a long day at work and I didn't really prepare for this, so it'll the ball will, once the ball gets rolling, it'll pick up, so bear with that. That's okay. So Exodus chapter 2, and we're gonna go, well, let's start with verse 1. And there went a man of the house of Levi and took to wife a daughter of Levi. So this is regarding the Levites. And a woman conceived and bare a son, and when she saw him, that he was a goodly child, she hid him 3 months. All right, so this is obviously speaking about Musa and Moses. So let us skip over to verse 22. And so it reads, "And she bare him a son, and she called his name Gershom, for he said, I have been a stranger in a strange land. Now, verse 23. And it came to pass in process of time that the king of Egypt died, and the children of Israel sighed by reason of the bondage, and they cried, and their cry came up to Jah by reason of the bondage. And God heard, and Jah heard their groaning. And Jah remembered his covenant with Abraham and Isaac and Yaakov. And God looked upon the children of Israel, and God had respect to them. Okay, so this is, Moses marries the Ethiopian Zipporah, the Cushite, and of course being Hebrew. And so she bears him a son and calls his name Gershom. And so, okay, so remember that these are the first chapters of Exodus. Joseph just brought, had recently brought all of his brothers over to Egypt, and so now they're dwelling in a strange land, and Moses has a child, and he names him Gershom because he's been a stranger in a strange land. So the Levites, Gershom is one of the ones that is appointed. His family are one of the three families that are appointed to take on the service and the burden of the tabernacle. And so just like the house of Israel now, the true children of Israel, the children of his majesty, Rastafari, which is I and I, as proclaiming that new name, Rastafari. And so if you could see the resemblance, we're in a strange land, and so Jah here I call because of our groaning, because of our cries, I could personally testify to this, but let's not get into that. So yeah, we're in a strange land, and Jah surely heard our cry. Keep in mind that the family, the Rastafari family, and the Levites, And so, that being said, let us go to Exodus. We're still in the book of Exodus. Let us go. Okay, let me just mention that all of this is kind of like it's needed information for I and I to proceed in the actual studies of the book of Numbers. All of this is going to relate and it's going to connect further on. So Exodus chapter 32, and remember, this is the golden calf. I apologize. The golden calf incident, if you can recall. So in order not to read the whole chapter, just remember that it's when, Moses goes up to the mountain, and then Jah tells him, you better get down there because your people are out of control. They're worshiping a golden calf, and so Moses comes down. Surely enough, it happens. Moses gets super upset, so I guess let's begin. It's Exodus chapter 32, and verse 26, this is extremely important. Then Moses stood in the gate of the camp, so he's on the east side, and said, who is on the Lord's side? Who is on Yahweh's or Adonai's side? Let him come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves to him. So basically, he's super pissed off. He's so pissed off that he makes them drink their own. I kind of got confused there. So, continuing. Well, he says, who's going to be on Jah's side, And the only people that respond to this is the family of the Levites, And so, interesting note how it says that who's going to be on Jah's side. Okay, so, and all of the sons of Levi gathered themselves together. You see the gathering. The Levites represent the gathering. And so, continuing. Verse 27, and he said to them, thus said the Lord God of Israel, put every man his sword by his side. Who's going to be on Jah's side, once again? So put everyone his sword by his side, which could also be interpreted as his word, and go in and out from gate to gate throughout the camp, and slay every man his brother, and every man his companion, and every man his neighbor. You know, so you got your sword in hand. Nowadays, the sword is in the mouth because we can't control it and we slay people. But, you know, if you keep the word of Jah, you know, and you could go gate, you know, gate by gate and slaying every, you know, not, you know, how could I say this in terms that I will not offend those? But regardless, you know, people without spirituality that cannot receive this just automatically assume that the slaying is physical. But whenever Rastafari open their mouth, the people get upset, they get pissed off, they get super mad because they cannot handle truth and they don't want to hear truth. And so this is, you know, and I and I can't keep our mouth shut, you know, we always open our mouths, and you know, that's what Jah wanted, because that's the opening of the seals, you know. Part of opening of the seals is opening our mouths and our eyes to see and our ears to hear. And so yeah, we're basically slaying every man, every neighbor with I and I words. And so it's a direct interpretation relating to I and I as being the only ones that have responded or seek to respond, you know. Jah willing will fulfill, but that's too soon to say. And so continuing, and the children of Levi did according to the word of Moses. And there fell on the people that day about 3,000 men. And New Testament, you know, Yehoshua, you know, he recovers 3,000 men. But that's to express how you can slay those that aren't willing to accept it. But then you also plant a seed within those that are of a pure heart and do seek to do good. And if they have little good, they will continue and proceed to seek that which is good and correct and exact, you know, within Jah's sight. And so continuing, verse 29 of chapter 32 of the book of Exodus, and for Moses had said, consecrate yourselves today to the Lord, even every man upon his son and upon his brother, that he may bestow upon a blessing this day. Okay. If you, I don't have the actual text, but if you read the Feth HaNegas, you know, the Law of the Kings, chapter 3, I believe, regarding the patriarchs, consecration. I'm not going to explain it, like, in full detail, but the consecration is, you know, kind of establishing a clergyman or a priest or someone that will carry on the service, the burden of the tabernacle. And so, with this incident that just happened, being that everyone was worshiping the golden calf, you know, everyone worshiping the bling bling, and which is interesting to note. Let me just mention that I've noticed, you know, you could talk about, you know, Yehoshua being black, and people kind of flip out and kind of get upset, but no big deal. You can speak about controversy and conspiracies, and people tend to, you know, get uncomfortable, but when you speak about money, people get pissed off. They get super upset, and they don't even want to talk about it anymore. I'm saying it touches their heart. People just give you this look, and they turn around, because you're talking about, now you're talking about their God, right? Because in God they trust. It says so in Baal or Baal, in the dollar Baal or bill, you know. And so they're false gods. Well, anyways, and then interesting to know, you know, give someone $20, and the first thing they'll say is, oh, may God bless you. You know, they're so, because you just contributed to their God. So, yeah, you can speak about Jah, you can speak about the word of truth, you can speak about all of that, but it don't matter. But if you give someone money, it's like, oh, may the Lord have mercy on your soul, you know. May God bless you and give you so much more, because now we're talking. Now we're talking about the real God, well, at least to them. But enough said, waste of time, continuing. So the consecration. Okay, so in the Fifth of Negas, it goes into detail. The reason that it says, even every man upon his son and upon his brother, it's, I think it's, It's because they need testimonies, and but notice how it says consecrate yourselves, you know, because at like Rastafari at this time don't have an established church, at least not physically, but certainly spiritually. And so it's interesting to note because let me just mention that reggae, Jah took. And the older generations, Jah did so much for them, like all the reggae artists and stuff. Jah brought them up from the lowest of lows at not in not as less humanity, but rather the circumstances. All man is capable of the same, possesses the same intelligence, and all man is capable of achieving the same greatness. The only difference is that the opportunities that are presented to man. Some people are born in the worst situations, others, have it pretty easy. And that's the only difference. And I say that because reggae, it got lifted up, it was born up into the air, raised, and then it's like they started making these bills, and it's like it wasn't about Jah no more. They completely forgot who had lifted them up and who made them what they were, and so reggae is out of control, but not all of it, right? But just it relates to the golden calf, and the worshiping of the bling bling, and so on and so forth. But for instance, go to the Bob Fest, Bob Marley Festival is a big thing in here in California, and they never even speak about Jah. They never even. It's like it doesn't even matter. We're here to make money, sell tickets, and individual artists. From time to time, give thanks and praises, but they don't go beyond that because that's not the priority, and that's a shame. And so continuing, okay, so let's end it there as far as that section. And give I just 1 second to kind of recover here. And so, well, I guess that's good as far as establishing the role of the Levites. Well, the beginning of the Levites. And so now let's go to. Okay, let's go to the Book of Numbers before, because I kind of lost it. And let's go to chapter 3. Okay, and so okay, chapter 3, verse 2, and these are the names of the sons of Aaron, Nadab the firstborn and Abihu, those died, Eleazar and Ithamar, these are the names of the sons of Aaron, the priests which were anointed, whom he consecrated to minister. So once again, the consecration on the fifth of Nagas, the third chapter, regarding the what is it, the patriarchs, goes into better explanation of what's going on there. And so, so basically, the Merarites, the Kohathites, and the Gershonites, are taking will take the responsibility of the tabernacle. Okay, I apologize for this, but I need more I guess more evidence to continue on with this, so bear with me. Like I said, let I and I go back to Exodus, like my bad. So but it's important, it's important. Okay, so Exodus chapter 18, verse 21 and 20, verses 21. And moreover, thou shalt provide out of all the people able men such as fear God, men of truth. Yeah, my bad. Men of truth, hating covetousness, and place such over them. To be rulers of thousands and rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties and rulers of tens. You know, back to the book of Numbers, how it's establishing the heads, the rasas, the majors, and then it breaks down the trinity within the tribes, you know, how three to each of the four corners. And so it breaks it down to lieutenants and captains and so on and so forth. And now, continuing, and let them judge the people at all seasons, and it shall be that every great matter they shall bring to thee, but every small matter they shall judge. So shall it be easier for thyself, and they shall bear the burden with thee. So explaining that. Okay. So that's kind of reinforcing the role of the Levites and how they are to be rulers and leaders of thousands, hundreds, and fifties, and tens. Now, Exodus chapter 30, if we could go there really quick. Like I said, this is all like backup information. Okay, here we go. Verse 15, let's start with verse 15. The rich shall not give, my bad. Okay, the rich shall not give more, and the poor shall not give less than half a shekel. When they give an offering to the Lord, to Adonai, you know, to Geta, to make an atonement for your souls. Okay, so we have what is the half shekel, right? And so the kaf. Right here, this is the calf, and the calf is like a calf, and the reason it's called a calf is because it's the hoof, which are their, like, I don't know, like nails or toes, whatever, they're parted in half, and so you get this sign right here, the hoof are parted, you know, split, and so the calf, and that also, you know, if you can sound it out, it's like half, and so half a shekel is the price if one wants to bring an offering. And half also explains divide, right? So division. And continuing. Yeah, let us. And this is important to know because it'll later explain the 10%. Okay, so that being said, let us go to the book of Leviticus, chapter 27, which is up here. Okay, the book of Leviticus, chapter 27, the whole chapter goes into detail as far as to the prices for redemption. But the one I and I is focused mostly is on. Book of Leviticus, chapter 27, verse 6. And if it be from a month old, even to 5 years old, then thy estimation shall be of the male, 5 shekels of silver. And for the female, thy estimation shall be 3 shekels of silver. So for a child 1 month old to 5 years, the price is 5 shekels. Keep that in mind. Like I said, this is all backup information. And so, you know, I apologize because we're going all over the place, but you know, keep these ideas in mind and then I'll make the connection towards the end. Continuing. Let's go to Genesis chapter 28. You know, I should have organized this, but it's kind of late for that. Genesis chapter 28. Okay, this is gonna be like, boy. Okay, this whole chapter is interesting. Okay, it's arise, go to. Well, first of all, if you go to chapter 27, it says, Now, therefore, my son, verse 43 of chapter 27 of the book of Genesis. Now, therefore, my son, obey my voice and arise. Flee thou to Laban, my brother, to Haran. Okay, it's kind of like the Shema, you know, hear, O Israel. And so, yeah, you know, Jacob listens to his father and he takes off and arise, go to Padan Aram, which is interesting because that's where the 12 sons of Jacob were born. And continuing on, you know, let's better explain this from, okay, verse 7 of chapter 28 says, and Jacob obeyed his father and his mother and was gone to Padan Aram. Padan Aram, or however that is pronounced. Okay, and verse 10, and Jacob went out from Beersheba and went towards Haran. I don't know if he's going to Ethiopia or he's leaving Ethiopia. And he lighted upon a certain place. So he lightened, he rested. Not a, and he lightened, like, you know when Aaron says, let not Jah's anger wax hot. You're lightening, you're diminishing weight because the candles are melting. And this is important to take note because in the instruction of what the family of the Levites are instructed to do as far as to carry on the services of the tabernacle. One of the first mentionings is the lampstand and to light upon over the candles, right? And so light upon a certain place, so a specific place, and tarry there all night because the sun was set. Okay, so the sun sets in the west. And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows, and lay down in that place to sleep. Okay, so what's going on here? He takes a stone, and so he's a builder, and he takes a stone, and he lays it as a foundation, and as pillows, you know, like in the New Testament, and the Son of Man doesn't have a place to rest his head, you know? And so this is to rest his ras. His ruler, his major and ruler of thousands. And so what's going on here, it's not, if you just read it, you'll miss it, but he's lighting upon a place. So he's illuminating a certain place. And he stayed there all night because the sun was set. And so he takes one of the stones and he sets it up. He firmly situates, you know, he establishes. And puts them for pillows to rest his head. So he's setting he's establishing a place of rest for his ras, for his leader. So it's basically like he's taking dominion of a certain geography, because for a pillow to lay down the foundation in that place to sleep. Okay, the reason it's establishing a permanent residence is because of the whole of to rest, you know, to sleep. Now, movement, you see, he's not moving because movement, work requires, well, this kind of explains the Shabbat too. Okay, work officially in school and stuff like that, in physics, if you study physics, work, you can be pushing a car for hours. But if that car doesn't move, officially you did not perform any work. So work is movement. And the fact that this is establishing rest is the laying of a foundation to rest his head so that the Ras, the leader of thousands, can have a stable environment to rule over. And he goes to sleep, right? Why does he sleep? And we'll get into this. And so continuing. Verse 12 of chapter 28 of the book of Genesis, and he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. Okay, that's, okay, a dreamer of dreams. And so, this right here, he leme, it represents fatness and a dreamer, the sweat and fatness extra left over. And so like abundancy and wealth and because when one eats a lot, he begins to dream. Well, my bad. When one eats a lot and he gets sleepy. And why does one eat a lot? Because he is rich and abundant and has leftovers. And so you fall asleep. And so this word heleme describes this particular action. And or actually, wait a minute. It's robust sound to dream when fatness, sleepy, dreamer of dreams, cause to dream, heleme. So interesting to note. And then there's a reason why I say that though. Hold on. Okay, just 1 second, please, or maybe 20 seconds. Hold on. Okay, I don't want to cut the video, but I'm not finding the information. If I don't find it soon, we'll just go with it. Okay, here we go. So it's fat, it's fleshy. Infant becomes strong, robust, sound to dream. When fatness, sleepy, dreamer of dreams, cause to dream. So, okay, that's describing the situation. Okay, I got completely lost it. But let's continue. And so, well, let me continue with that because there's so much more to that. And okay, so another word to describe that is wesile. Wesile. And the reason wesile is more like to make like, to kind of like, I guess, symbolize, I guess, but judging, forming an opinion, to think and to suppose, to see fit, to see health and to see like fit would also land in the would also be like I guess can be interpreted as power as heil and heile and so and the ale the el and check it out and so the this word begins with the wawe which would be wa with which is the name of the with like yod hey wow wow hey. Well anyways, okay if you take a look, this actually looks like a brain. And the fact that it looks like a brain isn't weird at all because of the nature of the word and the word becomes flesh and so becoming flesh it is none other well it can be there's I'm sure there's many more interpretations but as for this teaching or study or dissemination of rightly seeking to divide the word of truth. Well, divide, here we go, you divide the brain in half. And so you have the leftover, the left brain, and then you have what is the right brain, the righteous brain. And just keep in mind that the right brain controls the left side, and the left side controls the right side. And there's a good reason why that is there. And so continuing on, let's go to Madre. Madre right here would be like mother, right? But no, it signifies, in the Ethiopic, it signifies water. And so in the water relation, it's like whence, like, for, watery, have water, to pour out, to flow through a well, dilute, weaken, reduce concentration, and then so on and so forth. Okay, the reason I say that is because when you are abundant, you flow, you overflow. And so let's keep the flow, let's keep the movement. Okay, let me just get this out of the way. And but we are to flow singular, because the eye is single. And the eye being also right here represented as a circle and a dot in the center. And, you know, the well, and the reason the flowing is important is because if you can recall in New Testament, every time Jesus gets to, well, every time there's a well, and even when he rises from the grave and or the sepulchre, and he rolls the stone. And when Old Testament, whenever they're going to, you know, water the sheep, someone always has to roll the stone from the well. And so the rolling of the stone, you know, represents the flowing. And also, I guess the rolling is your rush to Jah, like your eagerness and desire to Jah, to quickly come to Jah, you know, roll out. And so roll in more perfectly. And we could even go into the extremes and see how the spiral is a rolling and movement. And I mean, there's so many ways to just go off from that. But the main, in this particular discussion, the main reason for the rolling is because it directly relates to the word pole. Whenever in the book of Numbers they're describing the word pole, it relates to the Golgoth and the Golgotha and the place of the skulls. And then a root word from that word is to roll. And so we'll go into that like as soon as it's time. You see, this is all information for this, you know, it'll probably be the next video, but where we can go straight to the book of Numbers. And then lastly, on the flowing and melting and dissolving is the word mechewe, to flow, and which is inevitably connected to all of this. Just throwing in some Ethiopic words to get to practice and to get the, you know, like the official business of the empire is to be, you know, to be held in the official language and the pure language, as Zephaniah, the book of Zephaniah, you know, it goes into detail as to the pure language, and so that I and I can, in one harmonious tone, in a single voice, you know, praise and thank and call to Jah. And so, okay, continuing. And so, well, notice how the brain is divided, right? And so, just that, getting that out of the way. So the angels ascending and descending, multiplying and decreasing, adding and decreasing, going up the pyramid ladder and coming down, and you know, so many ways to go into that. But continuing, verse 13, and behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am God, the God of Abraham, thy father, and thy God of Isaac. The land where thou liest to thee will I give it, and to thy seed. So here, I'm pretty sure there, you know, Jacob, in this situation, I think he just reached Ethiopia because of the whole ladder. And, well, anyways, because this is the land that I will give it thee. If not Ethiopia, well, Ethiopia, when I say Ethiopia, I mean the whole continent of Africa, and Arabia is indeed, in fact, and in truth, a part of Ethiopia, but people kind of tend to pretend that it's not, but it really is. And so continuing, and thy seed shall be as the dust of the earth, and thou shalt spread abroad to the West. You know, the diaspora now in these recent times, how Rastafari has been sent to the West, you know, and to the East and to the North and to the South. And in thy seed shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Okay, so going back to the book of Exodus, how consecrate yourself so you could be, where Moses tells the Levites, consecrate yourself so that you can be a blessing to the people. Well, once again, Rastafari, you know, Jah willing, in time, if I and I do all that is necessary, we shall fulfill our part. But as for His Majesty, you know, all glory be to the Metzhav Kedus, the Book of the Seven Seals. So, Scripture, let's continue on with the studies of Scripture and show thyself approved. You know, being workmen need not be, you know, need not be ashamed, rightfully dividing the word of truth. Once again, we go back to the half shekel, the division of word, right and wrong. What is correct and exact before Jah's sight, you know? Give thanks. All thanks be to His Majesty and His Christ, the authority, Jesus Christus. But, okay, that's continuing. Okay, and when Jacob, I skip over to verse 16. And when Jacob awaked out of his sleep, and he said, surely the Lord is in this place, and I knew it not. And he was afraid and said, how dreadful, you know, how dreadlocks, you know. But anyways, okay, is this place. This is none other but the house of God, Beth El, the house of bread, you know. And this is the gate of heaven, Ethiopia, the highest plateau in the African region, you know, the house of bread. That's where bread was broken and shared with all of I and I via His Imperial Majesty, you know, testifying His love to the authority, Jesus Christus, Yehoshua HaMashiach, you know, Ben HaElohim that came in the flesh. Surely He has. And then continuing, and Jacob rose up early in the morning and took the stone that he had put for his pillows and set it up for a pillar. So he lifted up the stone. He exalted it. He, like, Nasa, in the Ethiopic, it would be like Nick. Neshia, or if I can find that really quick, I'll throw it out there. If not, seems like I didn't. It's almost like the word Nasa, like lifted up and born, like born in eagle's wings, you know, lifted up. Yeah, it don't seem like I'm gonna find it, but well, anyways, it's something to the effect of Neshea. It's almost like one and one with the Hebraic. So, you know, I would have really liked to have found it, but I don't want to, you know, declare something that I'm not too sure of. Well, anyways, continuing. So, early in the morning, and he sets it up for a pillar and poured oil upon it, so he consecrates it. You know, the pouring of the oil, the pouring of the Holy Spirit, and the pouring of the, you know, the... Okay, just one second. Yeah, whatever, that was kind of weird, but who cares? The pouring of the water, you know, the overflowing, the richness and the abundancy and the gift, you know, because this is a land that's going to flow with milk and honey. And so, and he called the name of the place Beth El, but the name of that city was called Luz at the first. And Jacob bowed a bow, saying, if God will be with me, and will keep me in this way that I go, and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on, so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God. Once again, repatriation back to Africa, the bread, you know, Jah break bread and give us to eat. Man shall not only live off of, you know, bread, but of the word of of the Most High God, Jah Rastafari. And so if raiment, you know, that clean raiment, that pure white linen. And so continuing, and this stone which I have set for a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that thou shalt give me, I will surely give the tenth to thee. Okay, so he sets up a stone. Now take note of the obelisk here. And once, let's remind everyone that this is a circumcised obelisk, right? Exalted up into the air. And he's gonna give of everything that flows, everything that's extra, he's gonna give 10%, you know? And check this out. If you study obelisks and pillars, it only takes 10% of the whole weight of the pillar itself to bear the whole weight of the obelisk. So obelisk down here, like the whole weight added up, only 10% is needed to keep that obelisk as a pillar, as a freestanding, standing on its own. So that's a reflection of I and I, you know? The whole using your 10% of the brain, that's, I mean, I guess that makes, that's kind of a connection, but let's go beyond that, I would say, to support yourself. And I'll take this opportunity to say, support the line of Judah Society. Visit www.lojsociety, that's all small caps, .org. You know, check out the Ethiopian World Net videos on the YouTubes, and there's a lot more out there. Okay, continuing. So, okay, that's that. And so, give I just one. Okay, so that was chapter 28. And now let's go to. Okay, I'm gonna end this video here because I kind of have to explain a whole lot other things. I have to go back. I have to go forward to the Book of Numbers. So shalom. Stay tuned. Watch the whole series because you won't get the full, you know, you won't get the full, I guess, you won't get it all unless you see all videos. So shalom.